the things I want to share with you, this is a special day. This is a day I've been looking forward to for a really long time. And this is our Elevate Friday Night Youth Worship Band. And God is doing something amazing on Friday nights. And this is going to give you a little taste of kind of what they do. And then you're going to hear from Mike, our youth leader, here in a little bit as well.
Yeah.
One of the girls from the youth group as well. And this is going to be a Sunday you won't forget. They're going to lead us in worship. But I wanted to share one thing. Jason, who was just up here, which is my brother from another mother with lots of tattoos on his arms. Jason, a little bit of his story. He came to our church. It's been, gosh, has it been 3 or 4 or 5 years now? It's been over 4 years ago now. Him and his wife, their marriage was on the rocks, and he'd come to the liquor store next door. And he saw the sign of our church, and there was a sign that our secretary had put on the front window. And he saw that and got to thinking about that, wrote down the website, ended up checking us out. Him and his wife came to church that next Sunday, and they both wholeheartedly committed their lives to Christ together on that Sunday. Over 4 years ago. Now, here's what's crazy. Jason played in a secular band for years, but never dreamed he'd ever be a part of a church music group. And for years, Jason was our lead drummer for our Sunday morning worship team. But what you may not realize is, about a year and a half ago, Jason answered the call to become the worship leader for Friday Night Elevate. And so he's been leading the worship, putting the group together, the music together, for a year and a half. And so I want you to know that God still changes lives. Christ still changes lives. And, you know, it's just such an honor to be a part of New Hope, where God works in people's lives like Jason. And I love you, Jason. God bless you, my brother.
Love you too, man. Thank you, Jesus. It's all about me. It's completely changed everything about me. But I am human, so I still struggle. So, guys might wonder why we're faced this way. Something I've been trying to work on with our Elevate group is to not focus on the band. Worship is definitely not a performance. I mean, we're not here to perform anything for you guys. We want you to get into the worship, so, I mean, it takes the focus off the band, and so you guys can watch the PowerPoint or close your eyes or, you know, get away from your friends. No distractions, just you and the Lord, and sing your heart out or pray or get on your face, get on your knees, whatever you guys want to do. It's all about God, so that's why we're not facing you. We're not being rude. Get your worship on.
God, you are good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
And whoever finds Jesus, whoever finds Jesus, finds life. Absolutely. Well, my name is Jeff Frank, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope. And great to get to see some of you here for the first time today. You want to know that if this is your first Sunday, it is not an accident that you are here today. I believe every person who comes through the doors here, God brings for a purpose. And today he wants to speak some truth and love into your life. And I'm honored to be just a small piece of what God's going to do today. If you're visiting, it's not going to take you long to figure out that we are not a perfect church. And friends, that's because we're full of imperfect people like me and my brother Mike over here. But we're real serious about fulfilling the vision and mission that God has given us as a church. And that is transforming broken lives through Christ's love. And the reality is, Christ's love has changed my life. Christ's love has changed Mike's life. Jason, who leads the Youth Elevate Band, Christ's love has changed his life. And so we're all about sharing Christ's love with people so he can come in and transform our lives. And he's transforming us every day, just a little more, until the day that we die. And none of us are perfect, but we're on a transformational process with Christ. And so that's what we're about as a church. If you're visiting, let us know that you're here today. And there's a little communication card in your bulletin that looks like this.
And if you would, just fill that out. And at the end of the worship hour, take it to the Welcome Center right out back in the back foyer. Exchange that with us. We've got a free gift we'd love to give you. We'd love to have a chance to connect with you that way. So please let us know that you're here today. Also, just real quick, I want to remind the guys, if you're going to the men's retreat and you have not paid, please see Jay back in the red hat, back in the Welcome Center, and pay your $115 today. He needs that. So,
come back and get a flyer.
We also need all the guys who are going to come back and get a flyer. It'll show you exactly how to get there and a few details of what you're going to need to bring as well. So make sure you go back there and get the flyer from Jay as well. Today is a very exciting day for me. Something that God put in my heart several months ago that I began praying about, and that we needed to have occasionally a youth service at New Hope. And I'm really excited about what God is doing in our young people at New Hope. And many of you who come on Sundays don't realize what God's doing in our young people. And we have a group that meets on Friday nights that is called Elevate. It's for junior and senior high schoolers, and then also for young adults. And so that time is amazing. And today I'm really excited because our youth leader, Mike Cardenas, who works with our junior and senior hires, I've asked him to come and share the message today. And I have been over the last month meeting with Mike each week. And God has done something amazing in his heart and in his life. And God is using Mike to teach me, ancient 40-year-old Jeff. And God's teaching me some stuff through this guy, and it's helping me, it's growing me, and I know if God's, not that I'm anything great, but if God's touching me through him, I believe God's been touching you through him. And so I just, would you please welcome my friend, my partner in ministry, and my brother in Christ. Mike Cardenas.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Nice to see you all here. Careboy, stand up for me. I want you guys to go talk to somebody you never met before, find out a little something about them, and just have a little time talking to them. Who met you? I did. Well, this is it's Adam. And this is his girlfriend and his two kids here. And he robbed me yesterday as we were playing the flag football, but that's okay. Jesus still loves you. Right. Oh, anybody else? You're Joanne. Nice to meet you, Joanne. Welcome. Who's that, Curtis? Did you meet that person?
That's Joseph right here.
Nice to have you, Joseph. Well, can I ask my Elevate Youth Group to come up here?
Again. That's it.
You by yourself or what? All right, you guys, so this is what it's all about for me is God has placed a great opportunity in my life to minister to these kids and be an example to them, because everybody knows that you need a role model in life to follow. And when I was younger and growing up, the only role models I had were people that led me in the wrong direction. And so God put it on my heart to start teaching these youth what Jesus can do in their life. And God has done an amazing work in these kids' life, and they continue to teach me every single day what God's love is about. So I want you guys to meet them. Introduce yourself. Just your name and some things that you liked or whatever. Something about you.
All right.
I'm Brandon. I go to Prairie View. I'm 15, and I like soccer.
I'm Ira, I'm going to middle school, but I play soccer.
I'm Mariana, I'm 14, and I like to softball. I'm Mary, I'm 14, and I'm an amateur softball.
So the reason I had him do that, easy right there, bro. They get a little nervous and things, but that's okay. They'll step outside their box. I want you to get to know these kids, and I want you to pray for them, and I want you to encourage them, because they need encouragement just as much as anybody else. And she's right, this is our future. The future of the church stands in those kids' hands right there, because if they stop following God, everybody after them is gonna stop following God. So it's important for us to do what God commissioned us to do, and that's to make disciples of those kids. Pray for them. They need it. And so the reason God put this on my heart to do these things is, like I said, I was a kid growing up. I was going down the wrong path. I was on a path to destruction. I was following the world's ways and everything it had to bring. And God changed my heart. I was downtown with one of my brothers. We used to do club promotions and things like that, and we were walking down the street, and I heard the voice of God. And he said, Mike, you need to stop doing this stuff, and you need to start doing my work.
Amen.
And since that day, it changed my life. I walked in this church the next Sunday after that, and I sat in the back over there, about where Jerry's sitting, maybe a little farther back from that. I couldn't tell you the music that was played. I couldn't tell you the message that was spoken. But I could tell you that I felt God's presence in a way that I never felt it before. And that changed my life. And God is willing to do that for every single person in this room right here. If you haven't met Jesus on a personal level, it's time to do it today. And so that's what I'm going to talk about today. That's what God is going to talk about. Forgive me. Let me start in prayer to open this up. Father God, I want to thank you so much, Lord, for this day that you bless us with. And thank you for having your spirit present here with us, Lord God. I ask that your words are spoken through me, Lord God, not my own or anybody else's, Lord. And I ask that people have open hearts and open ears and open minds, Lord, to receive your message. Speak your word with love and conviction, Lord God. And we bless you and praise you in Jesus' name, amen. And so what changed my life and what is ultimately going to change everybody's life is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. There's nothing that you could supplement for that. There's good advice that you could get from somebody, from your parents or from somebody you look up to. They can give you good advice that'll get you so far. But as soon as that advice runs out, what do you have to lean on?
Jesus.
Yourself again, unless you're turning to Jesus. You were jumping the gun on me, but it's okay.
I know him.
I know him. Praise God. And so I want to take a look at a scripture. It's in John chapter 14. If you guys don't have a Bible, there's some Bibles back there at the table up front here. Or if you don't have a Bible, just raise your hand and somebody will get you one. I like to go into the real thing. I don't like phones and tablets and stuff like that. That might be a little weird since we're supposed to be in the technology age or whatever, but it's about having the real thing. This is what God has given us, and it's our sword. You get a Bible and you make it your own. You write in it. You write notes and things that God gives to you. And then someday you can reflect on those things. Someday, hopefully, I can pass this on to somebody that's going to help them. Because this is a sword. This is a living, active word of God. Get to know it and have it in your heart all the time. So we're going to open up to John chapter 14. If you can't find it, just ask somebody next to you and they can probably help you find it. If you've gone to Acts, you've gone too far. Okay, so I'm going to read the first four verses in here. This is a couple weeks ago, Jeff talked about Jesus washing the disciples' feet. Do you guys remember that?
Yes.
That's an awesome story. It shows how Jesus was a servant. That's something we need to take. We need to be servants of others. So these are the events that happened after Jesus washed his disciples' feet. He wanted to tell them something that was very important. And these next couple chapters that we're going to go through were right before his death. You guys think that's important to remember? The last things he told us before he was going to leave this earth, I think, is very important. So we're going to step into it. And this is right after, do you guys know about Peter denying Jesus? Anybody ever heard about that?
Yeah.
Okay.
He
did it three times. And so Jesus tells him, Peter, you're going to deny me. And he's like, no way, Lord, I'm willing to die for you. I can relate with Peter and saying, you know what, God, I'm going to go hard for you. And then the next day I'm failing. Anybody can relate with that? Just like Peter, we have a second chance. That was the rock that the church was built on. Peter was the start of all these churches, Peter and Paul. They started setting up all these churches. So that gives us hope, you guys. We have hope in Jesus. So this is what he says. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I'm going. God has prepared a home for us. It's not a home that's built by human hands. It's built by God himself.
That's the best.
That's the best. There's nothing like being in God's presence forever. I know, like, during worship and things, you felt the Holy Spirit. Did anybody feel it?
Yeah.
It's all-consuming fire. That's what we get to be in for eternity, is the all-consuming fire. A place where there's no more tears, no more pain. Complete happiness, being with God forever. And what he says, you know the way I'm going. And so this is what's said after that. No, we don't, Lord, Thomas said. We have no idea where you are going. So how can we know the way? Can anybody relate with that? Ever not knowing the way in life, things seem to be going wrong, and you're like, man, where do I go? What is my purpose in life, God? I've been there. I spent 21 years of my life there. And this is what happened. Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me. As soon as you see Jesus face to face, and you meet him on a personal level, you find that way. And he changes your life. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
God is in the business of changing lives, you guys. But it doesn't happen by us just walking through life. It takes a wholehearted commitment. We can walk through life. We can get so far. But when we really start living is when we start taking this to heart. So what I like to do at Elevate is I like for the crowd to interact a little bit, and I like for people to read the verses, because anybody has the same Holy Spirit. I've been given the same Holy Spirit as Clark, as Andre, as anybody else, and I want you guys to be a part of this. So I'm going to ask you guys to read the verses. Don't be shy or anything. Nobody's going to judge you. I can't read very well, so it's all right. So does anybody want to read verses 7 through 14?
God. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you, and yet you have not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen my Father. How can you say, show us the Father? You go.
Mm-hmm.
Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak from my own initiative, but the Father guiding me does his will. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, otherwise believe because of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to the Father. Whatever whatever you ask in my name that I will, that will I do. So that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments.
So again, there's somebody we can relate with here. His name's Philip. And he kind of questions God. He questions Jesus at the time, and he's like, well, Jesus, reveal the Father to me. I did the same thing when I first met Jesus. I was like, okay, now I met you. I know that, you know, you're a good guy and that you died for my sins and things like that, but I really want to get to know you. Anybody ever been there? And so Jesus tells him this right here. The words I speak are not my own, but my Father who lives in me does his work through me. His words. His words are given to us through this book right here. I found through this study that God revealed to me that there's three things that it takes to really be a committed follower to the Lord. And that's praying, that's reading, and that's obeying. We're trying to become pros. We have to remember those three things. It's not just about one of those things. It's not about two of those things, but it's all three. And so we get to see a little piece of it right here. The words I speak. These are God's written words to you, personally. God has written you a love letter, and he wants you to dive into it. You can go so far on your walk with the Lord, and I've been there, you guys. I have. That I thought if I come to church on Sunday, you know, and if I pray to God once in a while, that he's going to, you know, really start flourishing in my life. He wants more. He wants it all. He wants every day. He wants praying. He wants reading and obeying. And that's when you're going to see God start to come alive in your life. So we're going to go into the next couple verses here. We're going to jump over to John 15. And we're going to read verses 1 through 3. Does anybody want to read those for me? Okay, guys, so I'm going to tell you a little something that might break it down into easier terms for you. So everybody knows what a fruit tree is, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to take an orange tree. And what happens, there's a piece of fruit, there's an orange on the tree. It looks good, it's ready to pull off, it's ready to eat. I take that fruit off, I set it on the table for a few days. What happens to that fruit? You can't really notice much. You know, you see a piece of fruit at the grocery store, it's probably been there for a couple days. It still looks good. It still looks, the color might have changed a little bit, you know, but you can't really notice that much. Let's leave that fruit on the table for a week, or a month, or 2 months. What starts to happen? It starts to rot. The same exact thing happens to us when we disconnect from Jesus. We look okay, you know. If I don't read my word for a couple days, if I'm not praying and being in communion with God, you might not be able to tell that much. But then if I stop doing it for a week or a month, I start rotting and I start becoming fleshly. But if you stay connected to that, you're living. God is living through you and is bearing fruit. So let's go on to the next verse right here. Verse 4. Does anybody want to read that? Go ahead.
Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful apart from me.
Thank you. So Jesus is telling us if we remain in him, we can bear fruit. So we're going to take a look at what kind of fruit he's talking about. Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 22. Again, if you can't find it, just ask somebody next to you and they'll find it for you. It's in the back. Verses 22 and 23. Does anybody want to read those for me?
Galatians
5, 22 and 23. Go ahead.
For the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace,
forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. That is nothing but conceited, provoking, and demanding of the Spirit. Thank you.
So what Jesus is telling us here is that if we stay connected to him, these are the things that are produced in our life. I want you to take a look back on the last week and think about what you were portraying in your life. Were you being loving? Were you being kind? Were you being patient? Did you have self-control? Those are hard things to do. Super hard. And it's impossible without God. It really is, you guys. It is impossible to demonstrate these qualities without God. So you ask, what are the fruits that are produced if we're not following God, right? Let's take a look at those. They're in the verses right before that. They're 19 through 21. Does anybody want to read those for me?
You follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, delusion, envy, drunkenness, false parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, if anyone's living that sort of life, I'm not here for you.
So when we start to be that fruit that's pulled away from the vine, when we start to be pulled away from Jesus, there are things that we start to produce. Anybody ever been angry? Anybody ever been lustful of something that's not ours? Anybody ever been selfish? I can just keep my hand up the whole time. Right? And those happen because we take ourselves away from God. We say, Jesus, I don't need you anymore. You got me so far, now I'm going to go follow myself. Or, you know what, I didn't follow you at all, so I'm just going to follow myself, because that's what the world tells us. Be dependent. Be independent. Not dependent, but independent. You can do it. Just go out for yourself, and you can make all this money and get all these cars and get all these girls and all these sorts of things that you've ever wanted. That's what the world tells us. That's what TV tells us. That's what music tells us. That's what everything is telling everybody around us. That's not how it is, you guys. We don't want to produce these other things. We want to be loving towards somebody. How does it feel to be loved? Somebody tell me about it.
It's great.
Wonderful.
Mary, tell me about it. It feels good. It feels really good.
Oh! Everybody loves food, right? It's something that our spirit longs for. Everybody wants to be loved in some sort of way. And so we'll go out and we'll chase those down for our entire lifetime. We'll never find it. Only through God and only through his word, praying, reading, obeying, will you find that love. And so let's think about those while we continue reading this passage here. We're going to flip back to John chapter 15.
Oh.
And we're going to read verses 5 through 8. Does anybody want to read those for me? John 15, 5 through 8. Go ahead.
I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples.
Thank you. So there's a lot of things in this. Verse 5, again, it says, he is the vine and we are the branches. And then God gets real serious right here. And he says that anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile and burned. God is very serious about our walk, you guys. He's very serious about staying connected to him and producing this fruit. This is how we prove that we are true disciples. God has given us a deposit. It's called the Holy Spirit. That's how we know we have salvation. But what is faith without works? It's dead. If there's something that truly is coming out of you, and if you have Jesus coming out of you, you're going to do these kind of things. You're going to help out the homeless. You're going to help a brother in need. You're going to give an encouraging word to somebody, and you're going to put yourself last. Because that's what Jesus did. He put himself last. How hard is that to do? We have a lot of selfish desires, and I think that's the number one thing that will drag us away from the Lord, is being selfish. The realization is the first thing about that. And then you have to act on it after that, because you need that action. God loves action. If I just sit up here and talk all day, or if Pastor Jeff is talking all day, but we don't see the walk after that, can you really take them seriously?
No.
It's the same way with every single one of you in here. If we tell people about God, and we tell them that we're serious about following God, we better show them that we are serious about it. And it's not as hard as you think, you guys, because you have the Holy Spirit. And he's the one who actually does the work for you. You just have to not be selfish about it and say, God, work through me. And he will, because that's who God is, that's who his character is, and that's what he does. Thank you, brother. Oh, you got to clear up my walkway, man. I'll be getting nervous walking around sometimes. Oh, all right, so let's go. Okay, but I want to touch on verse 7. It says, but if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. What are his words? Come on. What are his words?
Right there.
Right here.
Okay.
Okay, so he's saying...
Where'd they go?
Oh. If we remain in these words, you guys, this is the reading aspect of it. Jesus has given us a commandment right here, and that's saying to remain in his words. Let these words remain in you. We have to read it daily. Can you read something and remember it forever if you read it one time?
No.
No. But if you read it day in and day out, it gets stuck in your mind. It gets stuck in your heart. And when you start going through your daily life and struggles start to come up, the Holy Spirit points you back to a scripture. And it says, you know what? Don't get down on yourself. Remember that verse. Remember my promise. This book is full of God's promises. He wants to remind us of those things and say, I will never leave you or forsake you. He has plans to prosper you and not to harm you. If you don't know those, the enemy will take you out quicker than you know it. Because he is very good at it, and he will tear you down. But if you remember these words, like Jesus tells us right here, that'll take you through life. And so we're going to read the next couple of verses. We're going to read 9 through 11. Does anybody want to read those for me? Della? Go ahead, bro.
Yeah, chapter 15.
Yeah, 15, 9 through 11.
As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commands, you remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you, so that your joy may be in me.
Thank you. Did you guys catch what he said right there in verse 10? When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love.
Just as I remain in my love.
And his grace. We have to obey. How hard is that for us to obey, especially like as a man? You know, I don't want to take commandments from anybody, you know? It's very hard for us. But God's telling us if we remain in those, his love will be made full in us. And then what he promises after that in verse 11, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. You guys like joy? Isn't it fun to be happy? And to laugh and to be cheerful, you know? Put a smile on your face because God has given it to you. Like, how do you guys feel after you get out of church? You feel good, right? You're pumped up. You're like, man, I'm on the Holy Spirit right now. God is running through me. I am joyful. We could be in that all the time, you guys. As long as we stay connected to him. Through those three things. And what he says, yes, your joy will overflow. When God starts living in you and he starts producing fruit in you, people start to see it. They say, Jesse, man, there is something about you, dude. I see something all over you, dude. I want a piece of that. Has anybody ever seen somebody like that?
Yes.
They're just always happy, helping everybody out. That's Jesus living through them. Their joy starts to overflow. When you start getting filled up with God's Spirit, it starts to overflow on everybody else, and they start to get it. You pass God's love on to somebody else. That's an amazing thing. That's how we become his disciples, and that's how we start showing Jesus' love to everyone. It's by him overflowing. It's nothing that we do, you guys. It's absolutely nothing that we do because we're just flesh and bones. And we're sinful people who don't deserve a second chance. But it's God working through us that does those things. So let's go on to the next couple verses right here. We're going to read 12 through 17.
Anybody want to read that? Go ahead, Adam.
My command is this. Love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than the man that would lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know what his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command, to love one another.
Thank you. These verses are packed with so much. This is the first thing. So remember, we talked about obeying. You have to obey a command. If you have no command, you can't obey anything. So this is what Jesus tells us. This is my command. Love each other in the same way I've loved you. How does Jesus love us, you guys? Unconditionally. There's nothing in your life that you can do that will take away God's love for you. And he's telling us to love others like that? Man, that's tough. You know, you messed me up yesterday at the football tournament, but I still love you, you know? That's hard to do when somebody does something bad against you. I'm not saying that was bad, I'm just joking with you. Oh. See why I invited you to church, man? Oh. But it really is hard if somebody does something bad to you. How hard is it to love that person after that? It's really hard, and it's impossible to do without the Lord. God is love, and he wants to demonstrate that love through you. This is a command that God has given us. It's very important. Verse 13 says, there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for their friends. Jesus did it all on that cross. We didn't deserve it, but he laid his life down willingly for us. I've done so many bad things against God, but he still did it. If there was only one person in this room that he would die for, he would do it. Because he loves us that much. Don't ever forget that, you guys. We pass over it all the time. We see crosses. We wear jewelry. We need to remember what God did on that cross for us, because that's everything that we live for. Paul says, I boast in the cross. Nothing else but boasting in the cross and what the salvation is that he gave us. Could you imagine laying your life down for one of your friends? Right? You might say, yeah, for a family member, yeah, probably. Okay, now go back to your greatest enemy of all time. Would you still be willing to lay down your life for them? That's real hard. Jesus did it for the people that beat him, that spit on him, that wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, ridiculed him, mocked him. He died for those people and said, you know what, Father, forgive them, because they don't know what they're doing. Let's love like that. And you'll see transformation in your life, and you'll see transformation in lives of the people around you. Because that's what God does. He transforms people's lives through Christ's love. And then what Jesus tells us after that, he calls us friends. How cool is that? The creator of the world is your friend.
Glory to God.
That he made that accessible for us to be his friend. How does it feel when you're down and out, you know, and you call your best friend and you're like, man, I've been having a bad day, you know, I just need some encouragement. And they encourage you, right? Does that feel good? It feels good. How much more great does it feel when Jesus comforts you and he never leaves and he just keeps encouraging you and keeps pouring his love and his spirit out on you, filling you with those fruits that we're talking about? That's an amazing feeling, you guys. And he's willing to call us friends. He's the ultimate master, but he didn't even use that power, you guys. He was the creator, but he's not abusing that power. He's given us his love through that. Verse 16 says, you didn't choose me, I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. Every single person in this room has been chosen by God. You are a child of the one true King, and he has chosen you to do a special work. Before the creation of the world, before all those things, he knew exactly what was going to happen in your life. And then you were born, and he breathed life into you. From the dust we came to the dust we returned. But in that time of our life, God has breathed life into us. And there's no life apart from God, you guys. There's no life. If you're living without God, you're living without the real life. God wants to give you those things. He loves you. And verse 17 says, this is my command, love each other. Didn't we already hear that? In verse 12? Why is he repeating that?
Must be important.
Must be important. Sometimes we got to get things repeated to us. Like when your parents tell you something, did you clean your room yet?
Sure.
Oh, yeah, you know, it's good. 10 minutes later, did you clean your room yet? We have to be reminded of things, you guys. And that's what the Bible is. It's a big reminder of what God wants us to do. But if you're not reading it, how are you supposed to get reminded of those things? It's hard. And that's our job, you know, for the people that are up and coming Christians, is to remind them of those things and say, you know what? Jason, did you get in your word this week? You know? yeah? I don't mean to call anybody out. I just like to have a good time. But really, you know, pick up your brothers and sisters because it's hard sometimes. There's weeks that I go, or try not to do weeks anymore, you know, sometimes days, that I go without reading my word. And if there's somebody to encourage me and say, hey, Mike, have you been reading your word? That's an encouragement right there. That'll be like, man, I need to snap out of it and get back reading my word. Yeah. And then you start to feel good. You start having life in you again because this is life. So, we're good.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And another big thing out of that is accountability. That's a huge thing. That's something that really did change my life when I started walking with Christ, is accountability. Somebody, you know, to check up on me once in a while and say, are you doing all right with these things? Because we can go around and we can put on a front, you guys. We can. Everybody knows how to do it. That's what we've been trained to do. And especially in church. You can go into church on Sunday and say, you know, everything is good, man. God is good. But inside, you're torn apart. And you're dying inside. And you just want to reach out to somebody. Don't be scared to reach out to somebody. Because they have the Holy Spirit in them too, and they want to love on you. They want to encourage you. Find somebody. Pray about it. Seek God on it and get an accountability partner and say, you know what, I want you to hold me accountable because I want to be all I can be for God. God wants soldiers, you guys. He doesn't want just a bunch of people walking around like not doing anything. The enemy's not worried about those people. He's worried about the people that are sold out for him and going hard as they can. Glory to God. He gave us everything. He gave us life. He died on a cross for us. How much can we do for him? We can live for him. And we can pray, and we can read, and we can obey. And so, the last thing I want to touch on is prayer. And There's so many times in my life when I've been praying out of my flesh and praying for selfish things and saying, you know, God, help me in this area and bless me with this and blah, 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 praying all for myself. Anybody ever been there?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's not wrong to pray for yourself, but don't just get stuck in it all the time. God wants us to pray for other people, too. So we're going to take a look at how Jesus prayed right here. We're going to read verses 9 through 19.
What?
That would be John 17. John 17, 9 through 19. Anybody want to read those for me? Marty?
9 through 19?
Mm-hmm. See what happens on the
tablet?
We see here is a total selfless act again. This prayer right here was right before Jesus was going to be betrayed and arrested and hung on a cross. And he doesn't even pray for himself. He prays for you. Every single person in this room, he was praying for you at that time. That's love if I've ever seen it. He set the example, you guys. Let's not be selfish in our prayers. Let's not be selfish in our lives. But let's let Jesus love on people. In verse 17, this is the reading aspect of it. It says, make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. This word is truth. There's no truth apart from this Bible right here. There's good things that people can tell you in life. There's smart people all over the world that can give you good advice, but it's worldly advice. This is the truth, and the truth will set you free. If there's things that you need freedom from in life, if there's addictions that you're struggling with, if there's anything that you have in your life that's holding you back, unforgiveness of anything, go find it. I encourage you to get in your Bible. I encourage you to find what God has given you to set you free. We are no longer slaves. We are no longer bound to anything. find it, you guys. But you can only find it for yourself. I can only tell you so much. Pastor Jeff can only tell you so much. But you have to find it yourself. You have to feed yourself, you guys. There's a point, you know, a newborn baby, they need a bottle, somebody to hold a bottle for them, right? That's at a certain point in your spiritual walk. Somebody's holding a bottle for you and feeding you. But then when you grow up, you have to feed yourself. And that's what the word is about. You'll never experience the fullness of God in your life until you find that out. And it took me a long time, you guys. And God's still waiting. He's waiting for every single person in this room. And he's encouraging them and pushing them along the way and still holding their hand and saying, come on. But tomorrow's not promised, you guys. It's real. Life could end today, and that's it. Are you happy with where your walk ended with Christ if life ended today? Some say yes, some say no. And if you're not happy with where you're at, change it. You're the only person that could change it, you guys. There's people that can help you along that way, and that's what we're here for, is to encourage people and things. But only you know what's between you and the Lord at that point. So get in his word, you guys. Start praying more. Start reading more. And start obeying more. And watch God do miracles in your life. And so I'm going to close with that. And I'm going to invite our worship team back up here. They're going to play a song for us. And during that time, you guys, if you need prayer of any kind, there's going to be prayer partners up here in the front and the back. And if you've never accepted Jesus into your life, we have an opportunity today for you to do that. We have an opportunity for your life to be changed forever.
So I want to introduce you to somebody that I've seen Jesus do an amazing work in, and it all became because she started becoming connected to the Lord. And she started reading his word daily. She started praying to him, and she started obeying. So everybody welcome Ariana.
Two times that the Lord could have took my life.
did it. And it may have took me a while to notice this, but the moment I did, that's when I decided to live for him. Now, I'm grateful for my permanent scars because they help me remember that God's not dead and he's always been with me through the good and the bad. And he's blessed me with so many things and people, and it will continue as long as I'm his soldier. Now, the devil persecutes me everywhere. My home, my school, family, boys, and everything else. And I'm pretty sure everyone else has been persecuted by him. Because we all do, because he doesn't want us to see, he doesn't want us to look for God. But we have to pray for it to get, not for it to get better, but for us to get stronger. Most times we want to give up, but the way God works, he won't let us. How amazing is that? Someone who won't give up on us. Therefore, we should be sold out for God, because life's too short to not walk with God. I mean, he is in control. Now at home, I've learned to honor my mother and father, even in sis. But my dad was never really there for me, so it took me a while longer to learn how to honor my dad. He honestly hurt me before any guy could. I still struggle with it today, but all I can do now is show him God's love and pray for him. I mean, that's all I can do for my whole family. I think family is my biggest struggle, but sometimes with some people, I have to remember that I can't help someone that doesn't want to be helped. Everyone expects me to be who they want me to be, but it doesn't really work out because I'm no longer of this world. I was hurting, angry, sad, lost. I am now happy, thankful, blessed. And thank you all for listening, and just remember to be sold out for God, because we may have our problems now, but once we get to the top, it's so beautiful and worth it. And the way I see it, we're all here on a mission, and when it's our time to go, we should be able to say mission complete. But for now, let's let God keep writing our stories. God bless you.